Well, I think that is right. One way to put it is that the ratio between that which a theory explains as the numerator and that which you need to assume in order to explain it as the denominator, Darwin wins out on that. I mean, what Darwin explains is everything about life, human life, animal life, plant life, the diversity of life, the complexity of life. Everything is explained by one simple idea. It's an idea so simple that you can express it, actually, I think, in a single word, heredity. Once you've got on a planet anywhere in the universe high fidelity replication of coded information, I think everything else then follows. You'd probably need to add a little bit more than that. On the other hand, when you compare the achievement of an Einstein with a Darwin, and a Newton with a Darwin, I think you need to be a lot brighter to be an Einstein. I mean, you know, any fool could have been a Darwin. It's Let me clarify that. It's somewhat baffling to me why we had to wait for our Darwin until the middle of the 19th century, 200 years after we had to wait for our Newton. You would think that the idea of evolution by natural selection could have occurred to any philosopher in an armchair from the Greeks onward. Not one of them got it. Not a single one of them got it.
But I think that, for me, it's funny that you say that. Maybe the grass is always greener on the other side, but I think, as a physicist, how much harder it would be to have been Darwin. My mother wanted me to be a doctor, and I realized I couldn't, partly because I classification was not, when I grew up, biology was classification, unfortunately. And I realized that that's just something I couldn't do very well. And I think, well, you probably know more about this than I do, but observation was such a key part of what Darwin did that I don't know if, I mean, of course, after the fact, anyone could have had the idea. And one says that about many things in science. After the fact, it's a lot easier to understand where it came from. But having the idea, I think Darwin, it's so beautiful yet so subtle that his expedition on the Beagle and all the years he spent observing things was an essential part of ramming into the skull of someone who, after all, evolution is everywhere, but at the same time, it's nowhere. It requires an understanding of cosmic time in a way that is essential to understand what's here and now. And of course, the same is true about, in some sense, astrophysics, but the fact that many people are comfortable thinking about the cosmos in grand scales, but thinking about our own selves in that way and understanding, I mean, one of the big problems of people understanding evolution is this realization that the Earth has been around a hell of a long time, and so has life, and without that cosmic time, the concept of evolution would clearly be wrong.
Yes, you have to be able to grasp the immensity of geological time. It's interesting, by the way, that Darwin was almost scooped by Alfred Wallace, and both of them, they were very similar, they had very similar careers. They were both naturalists, they both traveled the world, they both spent a lot of time in the tropics, alone, free to think. Wallace actually had the idea in a fever dream. In a moment of lucidity, in the middle of having a high fever with malaria. I love that story. I mean, I love the thought that it took a kind of fermenting high temperature in a brilliant man's brain to get this idea.
It'd be good to know what other thoughts you had at the same time.
I know,
time,
yeah.
Anyway, so.
But nevertheless, the idea, when you grasp it, as you say, it is very simple, whereas Einstein and quantum theory, you no doubt understand them. I don't, and I bet most people here don't understand them, because it seems to me to be much further from what the human brain is set up to comprehend. I mean, perhaps we ought to talk about that, actually, but maybe not now, but a bit.
Yeah, it'd be fine to talk about that a little bit. I'd agree with you. Certain things, like quantum mechanics, no one understands. We do it, but we don't understand it. That's vitally important, I think. There are certain things we will never have an intuitive understanding of, and it probably relates to evolution. It probably relates to the fact that we're classical beings, and the way the world behaves at a fundamental level is just something that we have no direct or even, well, no direct experience of. We can try and build up an indirect understanding, but we just, it works. But it is so counterintuitive to realize that at a fundamental scale, objects are doing many things at the same time, whereas you
going
and I
through
are,
two slits, for example.
Yeah, doing, yes. Going through both slits at the same time, and a lot more than both slits. But and we exploit that, and as I say, maybe we'll talk about that. But the interesting thing is, I guess, that to me, it's not so clear that at least evolution, and well, you get mail, I get mail, and it's obviously not intuitively clear to many people that what evolution is. I was telling you before, just before this, I got a letter last night because I was doing something that happened a bit on TV from a woman who said to me, "Well, okay, I don't know if she said she liked watching me on TV, but she said she did." But she said, "Now, I just want to know one thing: who decided which ape would evolve and which wouldn't?" But I think that's the kind of immediacy people have, and the confusion people have with evolution is a sense that that's exactly how it works, instead of working with populations. And so it is this beautiful idea is still one step removed from our direct experience, and I think that's one of the reasons why, people are so many people are abjectly opposed to it. It appears to go against their direct experience. I think there's much more to it than that, but.
Ernst Mayr, the grand old man of the neo-Darwinian synthesis who died at the age of 100 a couple of years ago, he put it down to essentialism, the modern name for what people like Plato, I mean, one could call it the dead hand of Plato. Essentialism means people think there's an essence of rabbit, an essence of rhinoceros. A rabbit is a rabbit is a rabbit, and rabbits have the same sort of eternal verity as triangles to Euclid. And I mean, maybe all the Greeks like that thought like geometers.
Yeah.
And so a rabbit was a thing which kind of hanging out there in space, the ideal rabbit. And so the idea of a rabbit evolving into anything else, or an ape evolving into anything else, is utterly foreign. But it seems to me that that's a different and much smaller order of foreignness than the idea of a particle going through two slits, and in some sense knowing whether I forget what you have to explain the thing.
It's absolutely ridiculous what particles do when they go through two slits. We'll do this now. When I throw a baseball, I'm a big baseball fan. When I throw a baseball, it takes a known trajectory usually, and ends up in a catcher's hand. And we can calculate that, and we force students through endless boring calculations to calculate that. But when you throw an electron, of course, it doesn't do that. It does everything at once. It takes every possible way to get from one place to another, all at the same time. And we can demonstrate that with a wonderful experiment that actually was first performed by someone who was both a doctor and a physicist, Thomas Young, and who also... It's amazing what they did then. He also was one of the people that was essential in decoding the hieroglyphics. But an electron, when you send it out, and there are two slits, will go through both at the same time and interfere with itself when it comes out the other end, and therefore produce a very strange pattern on the other side of the slits. Now, if you say, well, look, this is ridiculous. The electron either went through one slit or the other. So I'll watch it. And you turn on a light or an electron detector, and you watch it, and indeed, each electron goes through one slit or the other. And you say, aha, but then you look behind the slit, and when you're watching it, the pattern is different. Having watched it, having measured it, you change the pattern, and so you know it was doing something very different when you weren't watching it. And that is very objectionable. And in fact, Einstein never came around to accepting that as a fact of life, and it is truly one of the strange. Relativity is much simpler to understand. Quantum mechanics is profoundly unnerving because of that, and it has many philosophical implications that many people are still disturbed about. And it's an we're trying to understand. In fact, my own field, something I'm just working on, involves trying to understand if the universe is quantum mechanical. What does a measurement mean? Because if you're an external observer turning a light on an electron, then you can understand that you might affect it. But if the universe as a whole is a quantum mechanical system, which it surely is if quantum mechanics governs it, then what does it mean if you're inside of it?